In the World Cup, he wears the number 19 shirt. On his return home, he finds he finishes up the nation's number one. For weeks, Paul Gascoigne captures tabloid headlines like no other player in the history of the game in England. It's all outrageously over the top, of course, but English football has thrown up a rare and engaging talent. Bobby Robson agrees.
The most exciting and most brilliant footballer that I've had the pleasure of working with in the 8 years in the national team.
Bobby Robson, closer to him than anyone during this month, is our guide as we see again how Paul Gascoigne's world is turned upside down. He takes us behind the scenes and tells how he once threatened to lock him in his bedroom and of the pranks in the training camp. There's a hiccup over the national anthem and how he shares the agony of that second yellow card. We shall see how a 23-year-old on the fringes of international football at the beginning of the month becomes a worldwide star at the end of it. So much so, in England's first match after the World Cup, here against Hungary, Paul Gascoigne finds himself engulfed by adulation. As young girls scream and grown men stand to applaud every time he goes to take a throw or a corner. Gascoigne plays a full part in England's victory. He responds to the crowd, but still finds time, as usual, for a moment of fun. This time with the referee. No problems with yellow cards this time. All this is a far cry from a few short months before when England, given little chance, moved towards the World Cup finals. There are many, Bobby Robson included, who were unsure of Gascoigne's temperament and his ability to handle a white-hot World Cup scene.
Of course, we had doubts, yes. Yes, because I'd seen him play for 2 years before he came into the England side permanently. We had him in the squad for 2 years. But I saw him play regularly at Tottenham. I watched him and my scouts watched him more than any other player in England during the last year. I would have something, certainly 20 reports on Gascoigne's performances for Tottenham last season, outside of international football. So he was scrutinised. And while he had this enormous talent, you know, there were areas in his game which needed to be better. He had to be certainly more disciplined, more considerate, more reliable in certain areas of the field where he played. Because he played, well, I say, off the top of his head. He played without thinking. And some of it was unrehearsed and spontaneous and was fantastic when it came off. And some of it was awful and it was going to cost people goals, and as it did, you know, it cost Terry Venables a couple of goals from time to time. And he needed a shape, and he needed a balance, and he needed a discipline within the marvellous framework of talent that he had.
A wonderful talent, as Bobby Robson says, but anyone who knows anything about Paul Gascoigne also knows that he's unpredictable, and some of the times, in the most engaging way, he can be a little crazy too.
He was daft. A bundle of fun, but daft. And when I said to him, you know, because it got picked up by the press and they use it all the time, but the very next morning, because I said to the players, oh, you know, he's as daft as a brush, you know, let's get on with it. The very next morning he came out for training and he had a carpet brush, one of these, you know, 12-inch carpet brushes, stuck down his stockings, and he trained with the brush in his stocking. But it caused a bit of fun, and you need, as it happens, you need that player sometimes, that sort of player, around you, because he made everybody laugh and they got on with the job. And he was lovely to have around.
And Bobby has him around when he chooses the England squad for the crucial World Cup qualifier against Albania at Wembley. And that's a night when Paul Gascoigne comes on as an England substitute. England already 3 goals to the good, Gascoigne indeed makes a fourth and then rewards his manager with a stunning goal of his own. It starts from deep, is taken up by defence, and watch the man in the number 15 shirt. Gets past one challenge, goes past another, and finishes with a beautiful left foot shot into the corner of the Albanian net. And the love affair with the fans is growing match by match. But still, Paul Gascoigne must complete his international apprenticeship with the under-21 side. But two splendid goals here against the Yugoslavs make his full England claim now obvious to everybody. And he's in the full England squad on merit now, irrepressible as ever. And Bobby Robson now gives him a full game in a World Cup warm-up against Czechoslovakia.
We had two important games coming up. Brazil at home and Czechoslovakia at home in the March and April. By this time, of course, Platt at Aston Villa was having a marvellous run, scoring goals regularly, and I knew I couldn't look at them both together, but I made up my mind I'd look at Platt against Brazil, Gascoigne against Czechoslovakia. So he came in the England team in the second match against Czechoslovakia, and the kid was fantastic. He stole the show. He couldn't wait to get on the pitch. Some people are a little bit nervous, wonder how it's going to go. You know, what's the first 5 minutes going to be like? And, you know, do I just sit and let the game come to me, or do I... He went out and he took the game by the scruff of the neck. You could say he had a hand in all four goals. And this is the confidence of the kid. Because after the match, I said, well done, son. You've made three goals. He said, four. I said, three. He said, four. I said, how did you make four? He said, I took the corner, which there was a couple of ricochets. There was about half a minute of play after that, and then it finally finished in the back of the net. But he remembered, he knew that all of that movement, however long it took before the ball finished in the back of the net, started originally with the corner, which he took. So he claimed part of that goal. So I looked at him and said, yeah, all right, okay. He had the eye of an eagle in terms of a pass. He saw every pass in the book. He had the ability to play every pass in the book. He dribbled when he should have dribbled and passed it when he should have passed it. I've seen Gascoigne's game being in reverse of that, where he's passed it when he should have dribbled it and he's dribbled it when he should have passed it, you know, where he was mixed up. But against Czechoslovakia, you could say he almost had a faultless game. And the thing which really delighted me, apart from, you know, his ability his appreciation of what was around him, using other people, not abusing people, not dilly-dallying on the ball, you know, for the camera's sake, but letting the ball go and making the ball do the work, was his industry, his mileage, which I had always suspected. Although Terry Velmers, to be fair, said to me, you'll be surprised at Gaz's fitness, because we had a physiological test on all the players, and Terry said to me, you will be surprised at Paul's... stamina and endurance statistic, and we were. But in the match, he went from box to box all the time. Got forward, got back, you know. Had the ability and had the stamina to get forward from a defensive position when on the re-strike, and he did it all night long.
Stephen. Oh, and Dixon was on there. Actually, probably Stephen couldn't have quite have found the route to get the ball to him. Gascoigne goes on. Great angle for a cross now from Gascoigne. There's ball! And what a combination we've got here, Gascoigne and Bolt. No sign of emotion from the man who decides who goes to Italy.
Yeah. No, this is Gascoigne again, beating two and three players. And not only that, sometimes you can beat two and three players and mess it up, but he's supplied a magnificent cross. In it comes here, the kind that strikers dream of, and I'm sure Steve Bull wishes for in international matches.
Right, wanting to show off a little. No one to the left initially, but Dorigo started to go, got a lucky ricochet off Bielek. Now Gascoigne, this would round it off perfectly. Oh, yes! I think he said fantastic, and you wouldn't disagree.
Wow. Well, this just caps off a marvellous night for Paul Gascoigne. We had just remarked that he'd only had one shot at goal all night. But even in the 90th minute, he's got the strength in his legs to make that sort of run and produce that sort of finish. Great close control, dribbles into the ball, doesn't panic, drags it wide and smashes it into the roof of the net. Caps a great performance for him.
I think the one match which was important to him was just prior to going to the World Cup when we played Uruguay, because the Uruguayans are clever at that. You know, if they can try and get somebody sent off, they can, because they will go in late. They are cynical, to be fair. They can wind you up, you know. They can balk you and check you and obstruct you and do it cleverly, and you get irritated. And if you've got a flash point, which I thought Gazza had, he could retaliate and find himself get sent off. And we warned him before the Uruguayan match. We said, listen, this is your test case. You let yourself down today and you might not go to the World Cup, because that's the match for you to prove
it
to us.
Have you really meant that?
Oh, yeah, sure. Sure, not really, but we had to say it to him. And we had to be firm about it. Oh, he was always going to go, but, you know, you have to kind of... We had to try and, you know, sedate the boy down in terms of it all. He behaved impeccably against Uruguay. Never in trouble, never in the slightest problem all through the match. And both Don and Howe sort of winked at each other after the match and said, you know, we're getting to him, we think he's learning. And that was right.
So Gascoigne passes all of Robson's tests. Skill, temperament, stamina and team. So smartly suited, Paul Gascoigne and company are ready to take off for the 1990 World Cup in Italy. The base there is Sardinia. England, remember, play all their qualifying games in Cagliari. Better known, of course, as a holiday haven. But for Paul Gascoigne, it proves to be a base where he builds a dazzling reputation and turns his whole life upside down in the month that follows. He's got a restlessness about him, a wide-eyed, boyish sense of fun. He is in no way overawed by the prospect of imminent World Cup action. There are some who've been this way before, but for Paul Gascoigne, a relative newcomer, this journey to Italy is there to be enjoyed. His teammates love him. Some think he's a little crazy. As you know, Bobby Robson once described him as being daft as a brush. And those who know him will tell you he's never still, he's never quiet, and that you're never safe from a practical joke when he's around.
He was hyperactive from 8 o'clock till 12 o'clock at night. I almost had to lock him in his bedroom at night time. I mean, how Chrissie Waddle played football during that month, I'll never know, because I think he must have worn Chrissie Waddle out. Because he's one of these players,
they did.
At one time, I actually thought about splitting him up to give Chrissie peace of mind. But Chrissie loved him and felt he was a father figure to him and he could look after him anyway. But he was a bundle of fun. He was always looking for a little bit of mischief and making people laugh. But he was everywhere, you know, like you'd be chatting with Brian Robson and Peter Shilton, somebody on a particular subject, okay, and you would finish that. And Gascoigne would be there on your shoulder and you might say something, and you look at him and say, yeah, that's right, yes. And then you'd walk from that scene, walk into another room, and you'd get chatting again, and you'd look again, and there he was on your left shoulder. And you'd say to yourself, well, I've just left you, and he's amongst you again. He was always there, wherever anything was happening, Gascoigne was there, you know.
And Paul Gascoigne is there again when England set off for their opening qualifying match against the Republic of Ireland in Cagliari. There's a determined look about them as they set off to face Jack Charlton's men, with qualifying games against Holland and Egypt to follow. But first, the Irish. The crucial question, though, is how will Gascoigne's supposedly fragile temperament hold up against opponents who know him so well? We're soon to find out.
So, Paul Gascoigne with the free kick for England. Waddle's out there too. Waddle just running over it. Gascoigne whipping in the free kick there. Robson with the header, but it's wide of the Irish goal. Smile from Bobby Robson. Exactly the free kick he wanted from Paul Gascoigne. Waddle keeps that in play. Hoists that long one towards Lineker. There's a chance for England here, and Lineker has taken it. A great start for England. And Gary Lineker, the top scorer in Mexico 4 years ago, takes less than 10 minutes to get off the mark again for England. The ball in from Chris Waddle, finished off there by Gary Lineker. In truth, it bounced very favourably for Lineker, going past Bonner, but he was so quick to react, and England are in the lead. De Barnes, Gascoigne. Gascoigne available again there in a bit of space. Looks to play another 1-2, does so. He's there again. And another 1-2, and Gascoigne's there again, lifting a delicate little pass now for Gary Stevens. Up to Gascoigne. He's causing such problems for the Irish through these midfield areas. Turning again. This time picking out Pearce. And he's run on for the return pass, but taken down by Paul McGrath. Crossing on the far side. And Chris Morris will get it back to Paddy Bonner. Slight error there by McMahon. Sheedy has taken full advantage of it. It's 1-1. Steve McMahon just on as a substitute. For a moment, his control betrayed him for just a moment. And Sheedy pounced so quickly on that famous left foot. It's 1-1. So can England get themselves back into a leading position? Gascoigne again with that free kick on the touchline. Butcher's made a great late run up there on the far side. I wonder if Gascoigne has spotted him. So Gascoigne with the free kick. Hit deep towards Butcher. There's the header. Oh, just wide of the goal. Shilton holds his head for a moment. Butcher goes back thinking of what might have been. Another great free kick there from Gascoigne. And what a fine run by Butcher in on the blind side, and he couldn't quite finish it off.
It finishes in a 1-1 draw. It's condemned by the critics, who see little of value in it, but a point is a point, and Paul Gascoigne plays well and never for a moment loses his cool.
I was pleased we got a point at the end of the day, although I was disappointed. And that Gascoigne kept cool under severe circumstances, didn't let himself down, didn't let the team down, tried to play, tried to do things, tried to make things happen, and played sensible. I mean, by this time, he'd now played, what, 5 consecutive matches. And he felt he was beginning to play his part. He had never let us down, and in some of the matches, he'd been very, very good. His confidence was soaring, if he needed any more confidence. He felt part of the team now, you know, in a kind of a fairly rock-solid position, as long as he didn't do anything daft.
Well, next the Dutch, and they will pose quite different problems for Gascoigne and company. At this point, Gascoigne is still a fledgling World Cup player, now pitched against Marco van Basten, Ruud Gullit, a team of European champions. How will he cope with this?
He loves the big stage. He's a big match player. I mean, I'll tell you a little story later on about the West Germany scene, but he's a big match player. He knew he was on the same pitch as Marco van Basten and Gullit and Van Tichelen and Van Aal. You know, and all right, Robson and Shilton and Butcher. And nobody was going to beat him. Nobody was going to have the headlines more than him the following day. And these people didn't frighten him, you know. If Marco van Basten was going to do 2 clever things, he was going to do 3. And he was never going to let them beat him. and he had this, this supreme confidence, you know, to want the ball. He couldn't wait for the game to start. You know, he kept saying to me in the dressing room, what time is it? How long to go? Like, 7 minutes before kickoff. Oh, all right. And he'd go and kick a ball against the wall. How long to go now? I said, I've just told you, 7 minutes. Oh, all right. And he was so anxious to get out. Not nervous. Wasn't like intrepidation. Wasn't that type of scene. He was just so keen to get out. Couldn't wait for it to begin.
The Dutch fans have been reared on crowd pleasers from the days of Johan Cruyff. Now they're to see glimpses of another player, quite capable of getting them out of their seats.
He's going really keen to make his mark on this match. Beating two defenders, getting to the byline and whipping it back. Van Basten challenged by Gascoigne. It's Gascoigne who gets up first. Hit towards Barnes. A lot of work for Barnes to do on that far side, and it's Ronald Koeman who gets it back to Hans van Breukelen. Gascoigne. One past Koeman, that's no easy task for a start. Still with Gascoigne in the end, the Dutch closing in at the expense of a corner. Great driving run there by Gascoigne, and you can see Bobby Robson approves of it. I thought he'd scored again. Now maybe it was a handball. It was certainly a terrific England move there. Parker playing a full part in it. A lovely ball squared in here. Lineker hitting it against Van Breukelen. Yes, and it came off Lineker's arm there. The referee already whistling. Goal disallowed. Indirect free kick. Whacked straight in. There it goes! No! No! It was an indirect free kick, and the referee has disallowed it. It touched no Dutchman on the way, and it won't count. Great disappointment there, you saw from Paul Gascoigne and the England players, but it was an indirect free kick, we knew that. And Pierce's shot did not touch a Dutchman on the way.
So, as Bobby Robson walks off at the end of this match, he knows he is now nurturing a special talent. And viewers the world over are beginning to expect the unexpected from Paul Gascoigne.
Yes, well, I mean, he has this marvellous ability on the ball where he feels he can do anything. And he's always got a trick. You know, he can always be going one way and make a turn and go the other way. And he can do it against opponents, people who are close marking, which is the best time to do it anyway. So he's got this wonderful ability where he's going one way, he's being closely marked, some guy's going to try and take the ball off him, and he can do the Cruyff trick where he flicks the ball between his legs, opens his legs, flicks the ball between his legs, turns very quickly, and now he's gone in the opposite direction. And he could erupt out of that, so he changes direction, changes pace. So suddenly he's in one bit of trouble being marked, and the next half a second well in the World Cup was running with the ball, as opposed to dribbling. Chrissie Waddle is a dribbler, Barnes is a dribbler. And Gascoigne can do that. He can beat people, you know, in possession of the ball, one against one. But where he excelled in the World Cup was that he travelled over the ground, just merely running the ball, bringing it out of one position into another. You know, we need to get the ball 30 yards further up the field. And he showed tremendous strength on the ball and tremendous strength in the later stages of the game. And we're back to Terry Velmer saying, you'll be surprised at his stamina and his fitness. Tough on the ball, strong on the ball. Nobody could knock him off it because he had this wonderful ability of using his arms and getting his arms up and not fouling people, but using his arm to protect it. And he could bring the ball out of defence or he could run the ball out of midfield, 30, 40 yards and put it into a dangerous area.
In the last minute?
Well, that's right. I mean, at that stage, a lot of players would have said, it's not, we'll settle for that. Not Gazza. Gazza was looking to win it in the last 2, 3, 4, 5 minutes. And I remember he got the ball and he went on a solo. He went to have a look at people to see if he could get the ball at the other end and win a free kick or, you know, go as far as he could and beat the last defender and get in with a shot. So on that occasion, he advanced the ball for us when everybody else was feeling a bit tired. He was very strong away from actually, you know, scoring with a free kick by Pierce to win us the match. But he did good things like that for us all the way. Once he became part of the team, he exuded confidence.
By now, Paul Gascoigne is a prime target for TV and radio crews and the world's press as well. His teammates know he needs protection, and they are determined that he shall have it.
Well, I think most of the players realised they, you know, we had a gem in our company, and they were all very keen that that gem, you know, was going to work for us, and they all really tended to kind of look after him. Chrissie Waddle obviously took much of it on board, but, you know, I was worried about that because sometimes, you know, at 12 o'clock at night, not only was he not stopping Chrissie Waddle from sleeping, but he'd be in somebody else's room, and because I used to find that out, because he'd go for midnight walks because he couldn't sleep. And he just can't lie and read. He's not one of those sort of guys. He's always got to be talking or doing something or sharing his life with somebody else. So he would get up and go outside and knock on somebody else's room and go in their room, you know. And I didn't realise that in the beginning until it was mentioned to me. And I had a, you know, go to him and said, listen, you keep out of other people's bedrooms. You stay in your own bedroom. And I said, look, I'm going to lock you in. I mean, I almost threatened to lock him in his bedroom to keep him in.
Well, he is let out, of course, for the final qualifying match against Egypt, also in Cagliari. By now, all four teams in this group are level on points, and both sides here know that a victory will ensure a place in the second phase. A draw, at the very least, will lead to the casting of lots. It's a night of crippling tension. Even so, guess who's least affected by nerves and doubts? Yes, our man again. And it's amazing how many people watching on TV notice Paul Gascoigne during the national anthem. Just watch for yourself.
I didn't see it myself, but someone then told me that Gascoigne had been seen on television as the camera panned along the England team. Gascoigne sticks out his tongue at the camera, you know? And he thinks it's funny, you see. And he doesn't know between, you know, fun and seriousness. That's his problem. And I said to him, Paul, come here. I'm told that millions of people back home have seen you put your tongue out. And during the national anthem, God Save the Queen, you're putting your tongue out. You can't do that. People don't want you to do that, you know. So he was a bit embarrassed because I think the camera stayed on him a little bit longer than it stays on anybody else. So he does that. That's him. That's his youthful exuberance, isn't it? You know, being a kid and not quite grown up. He doesn't think 26 million people at home are watching that scene and, you know, are just going to enjoy the performance. And it's during God Save the Queen anyway.
Yeah. I think I can sympathise with how you felt, because I've got a feeling, either in the next match or the match after that, the camera again panned along there and he thought about it and the tongue appeared. That's just... Right. Do you remember?
Yes, I do.
But obviously, the message then suddenly got in and yeah. And it stopped him.
Yeah. I mean, I'm even told he said, all right, I won't do it, but Chrissie, will you do it? And Chrissie went, no. But that was him, you know. All right, yeah. All right, thanks very much, I won't do it. Yeah. But Chrissie, it's your turn.
Now down to serious business against Egypt.
Threat wide there for Parker. And now for Gascoigne. Seeking a way through into the Egyptian box and finds it. Gascoigne now for England. And last ditch defending there by the Egyptians at the expense of a corner. A lovely little run by Gascoigne. Pierce gets it in. Egypt struggling to get it away. Gascoigne again. Easy little dribble. He's got to the byline, pulls it back. Again a corner. Made for England by Paul Gascoigne. The Egyptian goalkeeper looking concerned, as indeed the Egyptian defence might. Lineker's right in there. England's corner. Gascoigne, deep wide, tried to find Mark Wright with it. It's Wright who's retrieving it here. Looking again for Parker. Gascoigne. Took two, they fought to stop him, and even that wasn't enough. Gets it back to Waddle.
Hey!
He was good on free kicks. I mean, there's the old expression, you know, you can put it on a tanner, and it was a sixpence, and he could. He had this lovely right foot, and he had a swerve, and he had a bend, so he could put it both ways. But he was so accurate, and we decided one of the ploys in the World Cup was to always take free kicks on in-swing rather than out-swing, stick it in towards the goalkeeper. And he got the gist of this, he knew the value of it, and he kept the discipline, and he used it at the right time. He didn't use it from when it was too far out. He always used it when it would pay off. And against Egypt, we walked one as his vital free kick out on the touchline, and we knew we could bend the ball in and over the back defenders and onto the keeper. And we had, right in there.
Gascoigne then with this free kick for England, down by that touchline. Walker still getting treatment. In fact, he's just off the field there. Walker, who earned this free kick, and Gascoigne wanting a yard or two. He's saying, look, Walker's still getting treatment. I've got to be able to have a run at this free kick. In there again. Wright for England! Mark Wright! A crucial breakthrough. Wright's first goal for England. And what a priceless moment to get it. Another fine free kick from Gascoigne. Up goes Wright. And the Egyptians have no answer.
And he bent it something like, I don't know. From the moment left his foot to the moment Wright has headed it, he's probably bent it 10 yards. And it was a dangerous, fast free kick going in towards the goalkeeper, right attacking the ball, and the goalkeeper's got no chance because it went so fast.
Manager and rising star, private words after a very public performance. Paul Gascoigne is truly on his way. Next, Paul takes his special talents to Bologna. Now it's the second phase, knockout time in the World Cup, and Belgium are the next opponents. Back at the training camp, Paul is trying so hard to add the necessary discipline to all his exuberance. He's even begun to take a close look at what he should eat and what he shouldn't.
The doctor did very well for him, but if he felt he was putting on a few pounds, he actually wouldn't come into the dining room. He would tell us, because if he saw the food, he was tempted. So what he did, he wouldn't come into the dining room. So he'd tell the doctor to tell Mr. Robson that I'm missing dinner tonight. I'm in my room. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. And he wouldn't come in, and he wouldn't eat at all. You know, he kept a rigid check on his diet. If he felt he was a couple of pounds over, he would miss the meal. And he did that frequently. He missed a number of evening meals to keep his weight down. He had a decent breakfast and a lunch, and he didn't want the evening meal.
Well, nobody looks more at ease during the warm-up before this Belgium match than Paul Gascoigne. By now, his confidence is soaring, but his manager is certainly made to suffer in those normally nerve-wracking hours preceding such an important World Cup game.
He was doing, special dives in the pool and people's 5.6 for style and 5.6 for effort and all this, you know. He dominated the table tennis scene, you know, he dominated the television. He was always wanting to play golf. I had to chuck him off the tennis court in Bologna before we played Belgium. The day before, everybody was told to rest. I found Gascoigne playing tennis with an American. And the American thought he was super. I said, yeah, but you don't have to play against Belgium tomorrow. He does. You know, and what if he falls over and twists his ankle? You know, or anything, you know, on a tennis court. 24 hours before a World Cup match. And and it didn't mean anything to him, you know. He thought it was quite innocent. What, but I'm just playing tennis. I said, yes, but you're playing football tomorrow, representing England against Belgium in a World Cup match, and the winner's going the last eight. Oh, yeah, that's right, yeah, sorry. You know, and that's him.
Belgium will be difficult opponents. Impartial critics make them narrow favourites. But here is a night, just as it had been against Egypt, when Gascoigne will again make a mighty contribution with a wonderful free kick. But this time, it'll be even more dramatic. First, though, Gascoigne is confronted in midfield by Belgium's star player, Enzo Schifo. And against Schifo, England ride their luck. But then Paul Gascoigne has his say.
To Gascoigne. It's Terry Butcher. Walker may not get to that. He was sold short by Butcher. Schifo now on the break for Belgium. Crossed in there. Gascoigne right back there. Well, Paul Gascoigne saw that danger so quickly for England. England's free kick. Gascoigne and Waddle across there. Waddle so often just runs over the ball and leaves it for Gascoigne. And this has become almost his party piece. Knocking these free kicks in, getting a lot of pace there, and Mark Wright on the end of it, but wide of the Belgian goal. Certainly they're finding these free kicks from Gascoigne so difficult to handle. Right up well, but the glancing header takes it wide of the Belgian goal. Oh, played in now for Gascoigne. Oh, a lovely touch by Gascoigne. Flicked there now. Pierce just over the top. It's a great flick there by Paul Gascoigne on the byline here. The flick there with the outside of the boot. Touched on by a Belgian defender, and Stuart Pearce on the far side onto the roof of the net. Kellermans. Gascoigne takes possession again for England. Parker's made a break down the right. Inch perfect there for Paul Parker. There's his cross, but it's wasted. Great ball from Gascoigne, though. Kleisters and Gascoigne getting past Kleisters. Long challenging run of his right to the end. As Gascoigne looks for a way to avoid the agony of a penalty shootout. This last minute of extra time getting the better of Eric Gerrits. He's brought down and it's a free kick. Can England snatch something with almost the last kick of the game here? What sort of free kick will Gascoigne play? There are 2, 4, 6 England players in that Belgian penalty area. So Gascoigne's free kick floated in there. To David Platt! A goal for England in the last minute of extra time! A great free kick from Paul Gascoigne. But a superlative piece of finishing by David Platt, a wonderful volley. As England now poised to take their place in the quarterfinals. Again, a Gascoigne free kick pays off. But who could have believed that David Platt would have produced such a magnificent volley at the end of it? The widest of smiles as we see again the free kick from Gascoigne, a terrific volley by Platt. Preud'homme, no chance. And England on their way in this World Cup. unstoppable, and England almost through.
So Gascoigne's free kicks, so delicate and so deceptive in their delivery, pave the way for two successive England victories. And after this latest triumph, he tells Jim Rosenthal all about it.
I'm absolutely wrecked, and I didn't want to go to penalties, and I was going to shoot, and I thought, no, there's too many people watching the tone for me to have a crack. And just got it in and looked, and Platy brilliant.
Magnificent volley from David Platy.
Fantastic volley, and I tell you what, when that went, I bet there was a few folks at home job up, and at the Dunstan Excels, yeah.
A lot of people thought, I would think a few of those in your local club up in Newcastle on Tyne in particular, that England would have settled for penalties at that stage.
We were, because they were playing well, but you know, we've got a big heart in England camp, and we're done it, Jim. We're through at the next round, and I can just imagine now what the social club's going to be like. Well, all having a disco.
I would think you want to be there, but physically one of the hardest games you probably ever played in.
Ever played in, because you know, like you say, these World Cup games are coming thick and fast. And just, I can't believe it, now I'm in the quarterfinals of the World Cup, and it's just fantastic. I mean, they passed it around so well, and all we could do was battle, and we'd done it right away through, nearly 2 hours.
I thought he was going to kind of, again, play off the top of his head and forget about the discipline, because we won this vital free kick. And he looked around, and I thought he was going to just play the thing safe and square. And both Don and I simultaneously sort of jumped out and said, ball! And he looked up and he saw us. We said, into the box, put it into the box. And he looked at me and he went, yeah, all right. And he put the ball right on the spot, put the ball behind the defenders, not onto their heads where they could head it out, but above and beyond them, dropping the ball behind the defender in between the space, you know, in the space between the defender and the goalkeeper. And Platt made the little run, just ran at the right time, kept onside and hooked it. But it was a beautiful, well-judged, well-flighted ball. Perfect touch, you see.
Was it against Belgium also that he picked up his first yellow card?
Yes, and unnecessary. He didn't have to go in and tackle the way he did. And we told him about it. Because after the match, he said, look, you've got a booking, and it was unnecessary. You didn't have to tackle the player the way you did. He was on the touchline. He was in trouble. There was nothing he could do about it. All you have to do was go, press him, close them down, stay on your feet and don't tackle. And he tackled from as the player was on their half turn, and he sort of hit the ball, hit the player, knocked him down. And once the player hits the ground, then obviously you're testing the referee's judgment. They've been told to be firm, and so he gets a yellow card when he should not have had it.
Even so, the celebrations are long and noisy. And no matter that we are misled about the actual date of Paul's birthday, that hardly matters.
Well, Gather, we made the mistake of following the official FIFA list. We thought it was your birthday today. We got you the cake. We're 100% wrong, but you thought you might appreciate the chocolate anyway.
Oh, so. I just love chocolate.
Sorry, it's a bit formal. Happy birthday, Paul. A month late, but better late than never.
Cheers, Jim.
Oh, rascal. Well
Thanks
done.
Very much.
Well done. Don't eat it all at once.
Cheers, no problem.
Oh, jeez!
I just love chocolate!
The goalie! The goalie!
Gazza! Gazza! Gazza,
this way, please.
here we go!
Swim, boys.
No, no, kid.
Look at him, look at him.
The Bay of Naples beckons. It's a quarter-final match against Cameroon. People are actually beginning now to talk of England possibly winning the World Cup, and they just can't stop talking about Paul Gascoigne. They love his skill, of course, but most they love his passion. And for most people, he illustrates graphically the growing spirit in the England camp. Now they wait for the chance to put England into the World Cup semi-finals for the first time in 24 years and the first time ever abroad. They know too that Cameroon must not be taken lightly. Victors over Argentina, Romania and Colombia, they are here on merit. But it's also another big stage for Paul Gascoigne, and once again he's never far from the centre of the action.
playing it forward again. This time it's Pearce, made a good break down this left flank there. The cross is a good one towards Blair to go for England. A terrific break there. A fine cross by Stuart Pearce. A magnificent downward header by David Platt. Well, the man who got that vital goal against Belgium in the last round makes the breakthrough for England, but in no small part, Stuart Pearce. A perfect cross, but what a good downward header here by David Platt, giving Nakono no chance, and England in the lead. Foul on the 38-year-old Roger Miller, on as a sub, but he outwitted Gascoigne there and has won the penalty. Koundé, the big defender, with the penalty against Shilton. That makes it 1-1.
He lost a bit of discipline in his game. He chased the ball. Whatever the ball, like, you know, here he is. He knows if we're going to win the ball, if we're going to win the match, we'll win the semi-final. He wants that more than anybody. Maybe not more than me, but he wants it as much as me. And he's made up his mind. In spite of everything we've said, he's going to now do a little bit of extra. And we know this. And this way, you've just got to be, I think, a bit careful with him. He wants to be the star, wants to be the match winner. And he wants to do everything. You know, he wants to take the throw-ins, the corners, the free kicks, paint the white line, put the net up, blow the whistle. And you can't do that. And he chased the ball. And he got out of position. And the fella he was playing with started to play behind him. Made runs behind Paul Gascoigne in the spaces Paul was vacating too early. And you can't get to him because, you know, the match is in progress and he can't hear anyway, and he's too busy. And you can't get him back into, you know. Now, Robson, if we had Robson, Robson would have said, hey, you know, would have got on, get back and stand there and play from there. And we didn't have Robson. You know, we had other captains, but we missed, to some degree, Robson's captaincy in the midfield with him. He needed... a mature player to play. Platt did well, but Platt was learning the game as well, wasn't he? He was learning the game as well, Platt. Platt's got enough to do without thinking about being a captain. Robson can play the game and captain. And Robson wouldn't have let him play like that, you see. So there, here he is, wherever the ball is, Gascoigne's chasing it. He didn't think it was a penalty. He thought it was a bit of a dive by Miller. He thought he just put out his foot and he used the foot as an excuse and pretended to trip over. But like I said to him, listen, he's 38, Paul, and you're 22. Now, he's played 16 years more than you, and he's won a penalty off you. And therefore, in that situation, he's cleverer than you. Now, you've got to be cleverer than him. So you haven't got to stick out your foot, you know? And that's where you've got to learn, Paul. Because you know, if you're going to play international football, you're going to play against clever dicks, clever people, people who know the game, and they'll take you to town. They'll paint the town red with you. And you've got to learn not to fall for that, you know? Don't be a fall guy. Don't be a stooge.
And here come Cameroon again. The other substitute, the 38-year-old Roger Miller, threads it beautifully past Mark Wright. There's Akeke with a little chip over Shilton. And Cameroon leading two for Bobby Robson's men now. They're just checking there with Lineker, who was brought down, that he's all right to get up and take the penalty. Down he goes. The referee had no hesitation. This is a real high-pressure kick now for Gary Lineker. If he fails, then England could well be out of the World Cup. But it's 2-2! First-class penalty, you won't get them better than that. And that when the pressure is really on. Deep into extra time now. And still at 2-2, here's Gascoigne picking it up from deep. Gascoigne. And what a lovely pass for Lineker! Down he goes! A penalty! Another penalty for England! And a chance for them now to take the game. Providing, of course, Gary Lineker's nerve holds once more. But what a ball by Gascoigne again. Absolutely inch-perfect into the path of Gary Lineker.
Got an eye for a good pass, and and he's got the ability to play the pass as well. Whether it's, you know, the outside of the foot or a floated one. I mean, that marvellous pass he gave Bull against Czechoslovakia with the outside of his foot over 30 yards, over the sweeper, dropping onto Bully's chest. I mean, that's a radar pass. And he has about half a second to see it and play it. And the Lineker pass was just the same. He threaded the ball through the eye of a needle, beautifully weighted along the ground, right down Gary Lineker's side so he could take it, and the fella made a bad tackle on Lineker, would get the penalty. Superb pass. Johnny Haynes pass, you know, all the great Platini pass, all the great players who can got about this much to get a ball through, they get it through, and Gascoigne got it through. All we had to do was have Gary Lineker make sure he scored the penalties.
Now Lineker. Well, he's been this way before on this night. Now England looking for him to score from the second penalty to put them into the semi-finals. Lineker, and it's a goal! England lead by 3-2. Actually hit almost straight at Nakoma that time, but the goalkeeper had dived out of the way. Gascoigne. Pierce. Wobble. So important that England keep their concentration level high now. Here's Gascoigne. This is a good break again for England. Still with ball, Gascoigne. Lineker up alongside him. Just wide. What a great break. England win by 3-2, and Bobby Robson, delighted there, takes England into the semi-finals of the 1990 World Cup, embracing there Paul Gascoigne. He knows the part that Gascoigne played. And a night of celebration for England.
It's been a performance of grit and character, but England are through. It's been a mixed match for Gascoigne. A brave one for Mark Wright, who needs stitches in a bad head wound. But what a night.
Fantastic performance, lad. We didn't think there'd be anything more dramatic than the Belgian game, but tonight it really was extra, extra special.
Yeah, it was. I mean, we didn't perform as well as we should have, really. And to be fair to them, all credit to them, they did ever so well. And we're just pleased, really, to get through. You need a bit of luck in cup competitions, and now we're in the semi-finals, everything, who knows?
Paul, when you were chasing the game and there was, what, less than 10 minutes to go, did you feel you were going to be on the plane back home tomorrow?
Yeah, I was felt that way, but I hate flying, Jim. Petrified flying. I thought, there's no way I'm going yet. But, you know, the penalty, I was a bit disappointed because of that, and that was keep flashing through my mind. But
what happened there exactly?
Miller made a run, and I thought I could get the tackle, and I couldn't. And then, obviously, he's passed us, and by that time, he knew he was there, but, you know, he dived, as far as I'm concerned, but I dive a bit, so I don't mind.
And yet you found a superb through ball to free Gary Lineker for the deciding goal.
Yeah, it's the first time I've passed of him in a season and a half, so it's not too bad. But it came at the right time for us because then we got the equaliser, our spirits went, and then Gary got the penalty, you know, and we're away again.
And Mark, looking at you, if it had been a boxing match, they could well have stopped the fight with that one.
Yeah, I think I'd have lost. I mean, we'd used up both our substitutes and everything, so I had to stay on. I mean, at the end, I think I was playing as like a right winger, and I think I lost myself. But all I did was sat back in the air and tried to up as much as I could. Didn't do much, but I think it was just bodies in the way.
There's one thing about the England team. It might not be the prettiest side to watch, but you never lie down and die, do you?
Never. We've got big hearts, and
and we're going for the Germans.
We're going for the Germans. Yeah, I was going to say three lines of each essay.
Yes, the West Germans, World Cup foes of old, they're waiting in Turin. They've been favourites almost from the start. But England's expectations are high, and it's Gascoigne who remains the joker in the English pack.
But he made everybody laugh. He could tell a funny story. And he had them coming out of his ears. Where he got them from, I don't know. Who was his scriptwriter, I just don't know. But he had stories every day. And Peter Beasley and Chris Waddle used to interpret, because when he gets excited, he talks Geordie, and people don't understand it. And what did you say, Peter? And Peter would say, he says, and then of course they'd get the message. I mean, one day we'd had one, one week we'd had a few injuries. Des Walker, Paul Parker, Robson, of course, Lineker with a toe, Mark Wright. So we had one or two missing from training one day. And we all came back after training, had the lunch meal, all right. They were allowed to swim and do a little bit of sunbathing that afternoon. Suddenly we heard this wailing. And we all thought, what on earth is that? And Gascoigne came round the corner, through the bushes, onto the swimming pool area, and he'd been to his room, and there he was. He had the toilet paper wrapped around his head and over his eye, okay? He had his arm in a splint, and again, as though he had a broken arm, broken shoulder. He had masses of toilet paper, like a wrapping around his left thigh. He had masses of toilet paper wrapped around his calf, okay? And he comes in like the Hunchback of Notre Dame. Oh! And has anybody seen the doctor? I'm in trouble, you know? Well, everybody just... And he just thought about this himself. But, and, you know, you needed that, you know? And there he was. And he had, you know, this head, shoulder, leg, arm. He got a bit of tomato sauce, and he put a little bit of tomato sauce on the, you know, he had a head wound. And, no, I mean, no one told him. He just thought about it himself. And he came round the corner, wailing and screeching and moaning. Has anybody seen the doctor? And fantastic.
However, it's a sleek and determined-looking Gascoigne who prepares for his greatest ever game. A far cry from those early days in the North East, the precocious years at Newcastle, the growing reputation at Tottenham, but even a month ago, little more than a bit part player on the international scene. Now, all that has changed. He suspects that he's as good as anyone in this World Cup. And tonight, he plans to prove it.
By this time, he was pretty much, I think, as good as anything in the World Cup was Gascoigne. He was certainly the best young player in the tournament, by a mile. But he was now becoming equal to anything in the World Cup, in my opinion, because his displays had really gone on the ascendancy all the time. But the one player in the World Cup who was outstanding was the German captain, Matthias. And Dave Sexton, John Lyle, Mickey Wadsworth had all seen Germany. I had some great reports about them. Dave Sexton came down specially to talk to me about West Germany. Matthias was going to be a handful for us. And he was playing exactly in the middle of the field, directly opposed to Gascoigne, provided I kept the same team. And so he was a little bit of a worry to me. I knew Gascoigne on the ball would do clever things, but I thought off the ball, Matthias would give us problems because he could come through there, couldn't he? He had a great shot. He could pass it. And I thought if Gascoigne doesn't come in with a decent performance, he just might have the edge on us. So I said to Paul Gascoigne, listen, Paul, one of the key issues is you and Matthias. And I was going to say several other things. And before I could say anything to him, he said, boss, no problem. Leave him to me. Go and smoke your cigar.
So, in the tunnel they wait, Matthias at the head of his German team. Gascoigne steals glances their way, his thoughts best kept to himself at this stage. But soon, those in the super stadium in Turin will see for themselves how he goes about his work. And it's certain that Germany's manager, Franz Beckenbauer, has made serious provision for Gascoigne's skill in his preparations. And Gascoigne himself, the stage is set for him. Little did anyone, least of all Paul Gascoigne, know that this would be the night when he would fly straight to the heart of a nation. Not so much for his skill or that compelling, upright, strong-running commitment, but for his tears as he falls for one of the cruelest moments in this or any World Cup. But that comes later.
It's only been a good start for England. Beardsley then with a corner for them. It's Germany getting it away, not very far. Gascoigne turning it back. Oh, a good save there by Bodo Ilkner. Gascoigne didn't appear to catch that all that well, but it would have just gone in. Shilton coming out. Ooh, there's a problem there, but Gascoigne has solved it. Got back very quickly, Gascoigne, and he was urgently required in his own penalty area. Free kick to West Germany. Andy Bremer will take it just outside the England penalty area. 2, 4, 5 in the England wall. Paul Parker, the man who's going to attack the ball. It comes off Parker, and it's a goal! West Germany! It's a cruel blow for England, that. As it ricocheted off the defender, you can see the exasperation there from Peter Shilton. And the Germans go into the lead. The little touch there for Bremer. Parker goes out to attack the ball. It ricochets off him. Shilton can't get back. And West Germany go 1-0 ahead. Joy from Franz Beckenbauer on the German bench. Swift challenge there by Pierce. Gascoigne can take it up. Germany still leading by a goal to nil. Played through there by Gascoigne. Waddle couldn't quite get on the end of it. Right. For Parker. Ball in there towards Gary Lineker, comes off the defender, comes to Lineker, left foot, a goal! England, it's 1-1, and Lineker has done it again. Cross in by Paul Parker, it just glances off the defender and falls in the end so conveniently for Lineker, but that's a good left foot strike just inside the post, and England are level at 1-1. German captain, and Gascoigne not easy to shake off the ball himself, wins it, finds Waddle, but then it's away with West Germany again. Pierce goes in.
The fact that he was going to play Matthijs thrilled him. He was going to roll up his sleeve and he was going to adore that challenge. And he was going to win it, and as it happens, he did. He was better than Matthijs in that semi-final, in that match.
So West Germany forward again. It's pass right, but Parker's there. Now Waddle. Forward this time, and now Beardsley. Into Gascoigne. Thomas Berthold there. Did Gascoigne. Oh, and the Brazilian referee is coming towards him. It's going to be a yellow card for Paul Gascoigne.
Did he have to tackle the way he did? He flew in at the boy, I thought. And upended everything, and the German bench all stood up, which unfortunately, I think, affected the referee. I think the referee reacted off their gesticulations, you know. I mean, we don't allow our players to do that. We say, sit down, it's got nothing to do with it. They all jumped up and it made it worse for Paul. But again, like I'm saying, he flew in. It was only half a booking, but referees are under scrutiny and it's on television. And so I suppose he had judged that it was a foul. My heart sank the moment the referee took out the yellow card. I know how Paul Gascoigne felt, but my heart, I'll tell you, hit my shoes. Because I realised instantly that was the final for Paul Gascoigne. Out. Because at that time, at that stage, you know, we were still very much in the game and still playing to play in the final. And I merely thought, oh no, you know, that means that kid won't play in the final. And that's a tragedy for him, me, the team, the country, our football. Because he was so good and he was superb in this particular match. Like I'm saying, the bigger the game, the better he got. Gascoigne realised, the moment that yellow card was produced, he knew as well. Because I saw his face change from, you know, being aggressive in getting the ball, winning the ball, to realising he'd committed an error and he'd been booked. And he knew now the final was not for him. Tears began to well into his eyes, I could see. And Gary Lineker knows him. Gary Lineker was very clever. Gary Lineker saw it immediately and came over to me, got close to me as he could, and said, watch Gazza, watch him, watch him. Because he felt that now his mind just might go a bit berserk, even more berserk than he had, you know, with the free kick. And I understood it. I felt you know, quite a bit about the thing myself. So did all the subs. We're all involved in it, you know. And, you know, he knew the supreme penalty he was going to have to pay for that little slight indiscretion. And obviously for a moment or so, he was a bit disturbed.
But Gascoigne, after some shrewd coaxing from Bobby Robson, seeks to put his agonies behind him and sets about helping to push England into that Roman final. He's a target too for violent tackles, this one from Bremer. But Gascoigne, to his credit, shows no histrionics. However, the German is shown the yellow card. It's a painful night for Paul Gascoigne in every way. And remember, this is only 6 minutes after the sky had fallen in on his World Cup life. His reaction, though, is one more step towards England taking the World Cup fair play trophy at the end of it all. So the match goes to a penalty shootout. A pause for more consolation from Bobby Robson. At this point, England still with a formidable chance of reaching the final. Gascoigne apparently apologising for his indiscretion. Robson offering what consolation he can. But for all the consoling words, Gascoigne's thoughts are entirely his own, and what unhappy ones they must surely be at this point. But there were more tears to come for England this night. With the penalty score at 3-3, Nottingham Forest's Stuart Pearce experiences the ultimate in World Cup nightmares. Now England are on the way out, and here's another player who needs a consoling word or two. And gets them from teammate Mark Wright. But that's not all. Chris Waddle then steps up to take his penalty and blasts it high and wide. And now the night is noisy with West German celebrations. So England are out, but they still have a match to play for third and fourth place. It's against Italy. Without Gascoigne, of course, suspended, they're beaten and finish fourth in the 1990 World Cup. It's the end of Bobby Robson's era as manager. In the end, he's left a healthy legacy. And in Paul Gascoigne, England now have a player who in a month is known the world over. No wonder Italian clubs have offered millions for his signature. No wonder crowds have flocked this season to see him play. And to think that at 23, he's got a decade ahead of him, with two World Cups, international caps galore maybe, smiles, and perhaps more tears too along the way. For sure, he's going to find it all hard to live with. But in the pictures we've seen here, we know his talent is remarkable.
From a talent point of view, he is a megastar. He can get better. Don't know whether he can improve his talent, but he can improve his knowledge of the game. That's what he's lacking, just the knowledge of the game. When to attack, when not to attack. Where to go to for the ball, where not to go to for the ball. Where can he try his tricks in certain areas of the field, where he must not even think about it in other areas of the field. And if he can do it, certainly you can build much of the team around him. I mean, you can't build all the team around him, but much of your attacking play, your creative ability, playing in the last third of the field, you can build around him, because he is certainly a very skillful player. And he's got a good football brain. You know, when I say he's daft as a brush, he's as daft as a brush, certainly off the pitch. And on the pitch, he's as daft as a brush. But in terms of a football brain, knowing what he can do and what he can't do and having the skill to do it, he has got a football brain. The boy is a dream. And he'll have much to say about the international football that we will play in this country over the next, well, 8 years, maybe 10 years. Absolutely fantastic player, megastar.